Southern Utah hosting its final dual meet of the season tonight as they play host to an MRGC foe in Boise State here in Cedar City as we bring you coverage of college gymnastics here on ESPN+. Welcome inside the AFEC, everybody. Spencer McLaughlin with you. Megan and Maddie McBride with me to my right in that order and to your left. And Megan, Southern Utah has been performing sensationally over the last couple of weeks.
Yeah, they've had a great two last meets. 2 weeks in a row, 197-125 for both meets on the road, which in and of itself is super impressive. So we're excited to see some good gymnastics tonight.
Southern Utah has set a road record in program history, just adding another change record to the history books for Scotty Bauman in his 32nd year right here in Cedar City. But Maddie, Boise State comes into this meet not worried about any of that, worried about improving week to week, and they're coming off of their strongest outing of the season.
Yeah, and that's all you can hope for really in the NCAA gymnastics competition season is to keep improving meet to meet, and that's exactly what Boise has been doing, starting out in the low mid 195s and moving on up to the low 196s now, and just hoping to keep improving on that score as they move into postseason going into conference championships in a few weeks.
The MRGC championships will be right here in Cedar City on March 18th. Boise State, Utah State, and BYU will come down here to Southern Utah University for those championships as well. Tonight, also a very special gymnastics meet for Southern Utah, their annual My Cause event. Southern Utah allows each gymnast to highlight a cause that is important to her tonight and then has one overarching cause as well. And tonight, that pertains to Boise State head coach Tina Bird, whose grandson Baker is battling congenital CMV in the hospital right now. And you'll see Southern Utah wearing ribbons in their hair and rocking shirts supporting Baker in his fight as he works to get better. We will have a very special gymnastics meet for you right after this. And dual meet of the season for Southern Utah and Boise State. Southern Utah hasn't lost here in Cedar City since 2021 against BYU. They have been a tough team to beat here inside the AFEC, and Boise State knows that very well. Last time these two teams met was in Boise, Megan, and it went the way of the Thunderbirds.
Yeah, usually when we go against Boise, they're a very formidable team, and they are a formidable team now. We did snatch that win when we were up against them in Boise a few weeks ago, but Boise did score a 196.5, which was their season high this year, so I think we're in for a treat tonight.
Yeah, Boise State certainly feeling confident under fourth-year head coach Tina Bird, who has been on staff for much longer than that, and Megan Scotty Bauman's been on staff for 32 years, so knows a thing or two about the ebbs and flows of this season, and he has to feel really, really good about where his team is at right now.
Yeah, he has a lot of experience under his belt. His coaching staff, very experienced, and to have such a strong team this year too, who's been performing so well this season, I think they're just in the flow of their season and trusting their gymnastics, which is exactly where you want to be at this point in time.
They have been over 196 in every meet except one this year. That was their first meet of the year all the way back on January 6th at the Las Vegas Super 16 when they bested programs that included UNC and Washington in their group down there. But both have some individual standouts, impressive lineups top to bottom to be sure. Let's start with Southern Utah. Megan, Carly McLean has been simply magnificent this year. Top 10 nationally in the all-around. She has been an All-American caliber gymnast.
And when you consider the types of gymnasts throughout the country that are ranked nationally, it's so impressive that we have Carly McLean in the top 10 going up against, you know, former Olympians at this point. And she has garnered every MRGC gymnast of the week so far, which really you can't say anything about that except it's really impressive.
It is indeed, especially in a conference that has been so pronounced in the depth of talent that they have on the gymnastics front. You need look no further than Boise State's roster, Maddie. Emily Lopez last week, a perfect 10 on the uneven bars. She'll be anchoring the lineup for Coach Berg's team in this first rotation, but it was not a perfect 10 that you could look at and say anything other than, well, that was a perfect 10.
Absolutely, and getting a perfect 10 is the pinnacle of gymnastics accomplishments for individual gymnasts, and I was able to watch that bar routine, and like Spencer said, nothing wrong with it. A perfect 10 in every way, and we are really looking forward to watching her gymnastics tonight.
It was the first perfect 10 on bars years in Boise State women's gymnastics history. It was just the fifth perfect 10 on any event that Boise State has ever seen. Not a feat you see very often anywhere in the country. Always puts teams and leagues on notice, and Emily Lopez certainly did that. For Tina Bird, the lineup on the bars, Talia Little will lead things off, followed by Erin Morden, Elena McGovern, Kylie Hamby, Courtney Blackson, and the aforementioned Emily Lopez. For Southern Utah, it's Ellie Cachola, who shined last time she was in this gym a couple of weeks ago in the home win against BYU, setting a couple of career highs that night. Carly McLean will follow her on the vault. Caitlin Coe in the third slot, Caleb Pardue number four, and Rachel Smith at number five. And we'll see what happens in the sixth slot. But we are getting set for the vault for the Thunderbirds, and it's the sophomore from Owosso, Oklahoma, Ellie Cachola. Southern Utah last week a 49-2 on the vault. Cachola had a 9.85. Has been the event that has been the weakest link for Southern Utah this year. Still top 25 in the country, a testament to how they have garnered their number 16 NQS ranking right now with the MRGC Championships just a few weeks away. And this is Talia Little, a 9.725 last week on her bars routine to start things off for the Broncos.
She starts off with a beautiful combination of a toe-on Maloney straight into a pack. Just handstand right on top of the bar. It's exactly what the judges are looking for. Blindfold double tuck, just that little step with her right leg, but other than that, great start for the Broncos.
That's always such an important thing when you're on the road against an opponent of Southern Utah's caliber to get off to a strong start, and Boise State gets that there. And here goes Carly McLean, expected to compete in the all-around once again, as she has done every week this year. In the fifth year Flippin' Bird, getting ready for her vault.
I've said it before and I'll say it again. Carly McLean is someone you want on all of your lineups. And here she goes on vault. She just had a little bit of a pike down, didn't get into the vault quite as quick as she anticipated, so had a little step forward, which will be a deduction, but second vault in, we got a ways to go. You'll see here in the replay, had to pike it down just a little bit. Step forward, but not a bad vault for Carly McLean.
She is following a 9.825 from her teammate Ellie Cachola. Not far off of her career best effort on the vault. And Erin Morden, the senior from La Quinta, California, in aftershock gymnastics, competing on bars for the third straight week, had not competed in any event prior to the last couple of lineup rollouts for Coach Tina Bird, who is putting plenty of confidence in her senior.
On bars, there's a few things you're going to want to be looking for in each routine. You're going to want to look for those cast to handstands hitting right on top of the bar, huge dynamic release moves, and of course the stuck dismount. She's doing an under the bar mount. Beautiful cast a handstand right on top of the bar. Blind change. Ooh, looks like she let go just a little bit too early. Didn't get her heels up quite enough on the backside. So that will count as a 5/10 deduction.
And that'll ramp up the pressure on the rest of the Boise State lineup as she gets ready to reload.
Definitely. Gets right back up. Nice bail to handstand. Winding up for that dismount. Beautiful full in dismount. It looks like she did let go a little early, took a step forward. That will count as a fall for the Broncos, but hopefully they'll wind back up and have the rest of their team hit.
Now, one of the three co-sisters in the house tonight, the oldest, Caitlin Coe, is up for Southern Utah with her ball.
And she does.
will be quite a bit of pressure on the rest of the athletes for the lineup, because you have six gymnasts that go up and compete, and you have five scores that count. And so with that one fall, that score will be a lot lower than the rest of the scores. And if you count one more fall, then your score is going to be significantly lower.
Well, while she's waiting, Caitlin Coe was getting some extra applause and a little bit of mobbing by her teammates down here to our left. And even 9.9 for Caitlin Coe, that matches her career high, third time in her career. She's scored 9.9 flat. So Southern Utah, after a 9.7 from Carly McLean, has got a 9.825 and a 9.9 counting as well. Talia Little, a 9.8 for Boise State. So the one score that they do hope to be counting, certainly a good one for the Broncos.
Definitely. Another under-the-bar mount, a rule for NCAA gymnastics on bars is that you can only do one kip squat on in the routine. It looks like she just did a ginger connected to a bail. That angle on the bail was a little bit low. She will get deducted for that. Winding up for that dismount into a beautiful full out. Looks like she tried to cover for that little hop forward, but other than that, I think the momentum is going to keep rolling for the Broncos after that fall.
Talented freshman Kayla Pardue matched her career high last week in the win at Utah State with a 9.875.
Another 1.5 for the Thunderbirds from Kayla. She had beautiful form throughout that ball. Straight legs, straight body. Just a small step on the landing. Not quite as much distance as Kate Gold, but still an amazing vault. And again, the difficulty of this vault is pretty astounding, and they both have done it so well tonight. They should be very happy with those vaults.
And the talent of Kayla Pardue on display every week. This is a deep and talented Southern Utah team, and she is a true freshman, has competed on vault every single week. That's really impressive for such a young gymnast.
Definitely, and to have a freshman not only in the vault lineup, but competing a 10-0 start value vault for the Thunderbirds is a feat any team would want to have.
Kylie Hamby is up next, a freshman in her own right, one of six young newcomers on this Boise State roster for Tina Bird in her fourth season as the head coach, but her 33rd on staff. Spent 11 years as the co-ed coach before being given that solo title in 2020. And she sends Kylie Hamby out to keep things rolling.
Beautiful kip cast to handstand right into a huge ray connected to a bail. Lots of difficulty in that connection right there. Great handstand, maybe just a tad bit short. Right into a double A dismount, just a tiny hop forward, but other than that, a great routine for the Broncos.
Senior Rachel Smith, who matched the season high with her vault last week at Utah State, notching a 9.825.
This is another 10-0 start value vault for the Thunderbirds. Awesome vault for Rachel. Just a little hop on that landing, but she had a chest up. Nice, clean vault. And that'll be a great score for the Thunderbirds. Again, another 10-0 start value vault, which is very important where the Yurchenko fulls in the lineup are only a 9.95. You get a half tenth advantage starting with the 10-0.
A 9.825 is rolled in for Kayla Pardue. The score is a little bit slower on the Boise State side of things. McGovern a 9.65 after Little's 9.8 to start things off. We're still waiting on the score from Kylie Hamby.
That's one thing that's unpredictable about gymnastics is on the floor, you never know how long the judges are going to take, if they have to conference, what they're talking about. So you always just have to be mentally ready to go for your routine, whether you're waiting for 30 seconds, whether you're waiting for 2 minutes, even up to 5 minutes. You just have to stay in your headspace and be ready to go.
And a two-time MRGC Bars Specialist of the Week is up now, the junior Courtney Blackson. Elk Grove, California native, upset up next for the Broncos on the bars.
And this is exactly the kind of person you're going to want late in your lineup, someone who has a lot of experience and who has a lot of consistency.
She's top 20 nationally on the uneven bars this year with an NQS of 9905.
And you can see why, just how beautiful her lines are, going straight into a huge release move, so much amplitude over the bar. Just such clean lines, clean, beautiful dismount, stuck double A. That should be a huge score for the Broncos on bars.
Exactly what Boise State was looking for. And it's the first vault of Kennedy McLean's young career. The younger sister of Carly McLean, the true freshman, off and ready.
Kennedy has a huge retrieval throw. You see, she had that hop backwards, but to have a good start off vault, to be that big, and you can see she just attacked it with confidence. It's just a really exciting night for Kennedy. She'll be very proud of that vault for her debut in the apex.
So after the first five vaults, all land for Scotty Bomini, inserts the true freshman.
See how big that vault is? She did have a little bit of a pike down, which led to that step and hop back, but again, with time, Kennedy's a freshman, that vault is just going to get better and better, and we're excited to see it.
Well, it's certainly in her DNA. Carly McLean, one of the best gymnasts in the country this year. And speaking of which, here's the star of last week's win for Boise State, Emily Lopez, who notched the first perfect 10 on bars in Boise State history. Just the fifth Bronco all-time on any apparatus to have a perfect 10.
And again, another person that you want at the end of your lineup. Just from that 10 alone last week, you can tell she's consistent and she's clean and she's confident. Beautiful cast to handstand. You can tell she bounced that bar a little bit at the top. Beautiful piked Jaeger. That does add a little bit more difficulty to the skill. Beautiful bail to the low bar. Her lines are so clean and tight, and she's so confident in hitting those handstands just like that. Great double A dismount. I think they might count that as a stick. They might count as a tiny hop, but you can tell by that routine just how well executed she does bars and how well deserved that 10 was last week.
Well, Tina Bird turned to a couple of juniors to anchor the bars rotation, and after the fall and the early going, they certainly needed it, and her team responded very well. We'll tally up all the scores from rotation number one and get you set for the second. College gymnastics still coming your way here in Cedar City. Emily Lopez with a 9.95, the highest score of the first rotation. So Boise State ends with a 9.95 from Lopez and a 9.925 from Courtney Blackson. An excellent finish to that first rotation. Exactly what Tina Bird was looking for after that fall early in the lineup, Megan.
Yeah, especially with the fall early in the lineup, you're going to want to put your best athletes forward, because if you have to count more than one fall, it will be a detriment to your score later on. And to have those two nationally ranked gymnasts at the end of your lineup, you know, there's really very little stress going into those last routines, because you have so much confidence in their ability to not only hit a bar routine, but to hit it with precision and cleanliness and to have that stick landing at the end.
Meanwhile, on the other side, bragging rights for the younger McLean sister as she notches a 9.725, the true freshman, her first career vault, and Carly McLean a 9.7. Not the best that Carly has done this season, but I'm sure Kennedy is probably okay with that, because that I just have to feel like at some conversation at some point in time that has got to come up.
I'm gonna look at it from a different perspective and say, how cool for Carly to have a sister that when she might not have her best performance out, Carly knows that Kennedy has her back and getting a better score for her team, right?
That is definitely the other way to look at it. Now, did either of you ever outscore one another on the same event in the same meet that you can recall?
Yeah, it was probably Megan outscoring me most of the time.
The humble approach. You have more humility than I. So Southern Utah with a 49.075, they were leading for most of that first rotation, but the pair of 9.9 plus scores there at the end puts Boise State into the lead. Lopez and Blackson really, really brought it home there.
just you can just tell by their gymnastics the caliber of excellence that Boise State holds for their gymnasts, and that's why those two gymnasts in particular are ranked so highly, because they put out that excellence in every single routine that they do, and that's just the excellence that they expect of themselves. And I think Boise should feel really good going into their next rotation with that 49.175 on bars.
That 49.175, a season best mark on the uneven bars for the Broncos, and doing it on the road, no less, has to feel really, really good.
Absolutely. I mean, to get a season high on an event out of the way, where the equipment isn't the same, where the crowd isn't the same, and you've traveled a long way, is a very impressive feat. And I think that's nothing to turn your head at. And I think going into the next event, especially having the fall, they just move right past it and are ready to go into the next event and to attack it and move on in this meet and see where it goes with them.
Now the touch period rolling along here. We've got about 90 seconds until the second rotation begins. But Megan, this is a place that Southern Utah has been before. Last time they were here at home against BYU, they were trailing after that first rotation. They were under 49 with their vault lineup, and then they came back, ultimately got the win against the Cougars, putting up a 196.925. So there's still a long way to go. And sometimes, frankly, if when an opponent comes in and gets you in that first rotation on your home floor, it can light a fire under the team.
Of course, yeah. And we're only trailing by 1/10, and it really comes down to the nitty-gritties of everything, every toe point, every landing, every handstand. But it takes four events to win a meet, so I think for both teams, they're just moving on to the next event and focusing on the gymnastics they can do and not on the gymnastics they've already done.
Courtney Blackson, by the way, for Boise State, ties her career high with the 9.925. Emily Lopez, a lower score than last week. I'm sure that will be tremendously disappointing for the Broncos. Sarcasm, of course, as she's notched a perfect 10 last week. But now Southern Utah goes over to the bars, and Caitlin Coe is set to lead things off. We were talking about sisterly bragging rights earlier with Kennedy and Carly McLean, but there's a little bit of opposing sides sisterly rivalry going on here, too. Kaylee Coe and Caitlin Coe on Southern Utah. Sydney Coe, who is scheduled to lead off here on the vault for Boise State, the youngest of those sisters on the other side. You can have a lot of positive family talk, or you could have a lot of smack talk and not so many conversations. There's a number of different ways this could go.
Definitely. I mean, knowing the Coes, they're pretty awesome, so I'm sure it's a lot of positivity, building off the energy, cheering across the team for their sisters. I think it's going to be a really fun meet for these three to share together.
Well, Sydney Coe, the freshman, a 9.725 last week, matched her career high in her young gymnastics career. And her elder two sisters not watching at the moment, focused on the task in front of them. At least Caitlin Coe is, as she's scheduled to be up first on the bars for the Flippin' Birds. But off we go with rotation number two.
Distance on those vaults, but a really big Ruchenko full, a great way to start off the vault rotation for the Broncos.
So from the youngest Co to the eldest over on the bars, Caitlin Co ready to get things going here in rotation number two. A 9.85 last week at Utah State up in Logan matched her season high, and not far off of her career best, 9.875. She has gotten a go-ahead. Off she goes.
Caitlin Coe is a staple on bars. She is a super senior, and she has competed in bars for most of her career, so she has a lot of confidence and a lot of hit routines under her belt. Starting off with a beautiful Loney connected straight to a pack salto. Beautiful pirouette, maybe a little bit short of handstand there. That will be a little deduction. Great cast a handstand, toe on into a full-in dismount. Just a little bit step backwards, but altogether that was a really clean routine, clean combos, and they should be happy with that start on bars.
Emma Loyum is up, another underclassman, of which there are 11 on this Boise State roster. 11 of the 18 athletes, freshmen or sophomores for Tina Bird's team. off their best performance of the year last week. And Loy, I'm ready to go.
Are your chin goes layout half? That's not one you see very often. A pretty good hop forward, but that just shows how much power she has going into this vault. And if you watch this replay, she just opens up just a little bit earlier, finds that floor again, another difficult blind landing. We'll find that landing and we'll get a great vault.
Sydney Coe started things off for Boise State with a 9.725. We have not seen what Caitlin Coe garnered for Southern Utah, but it's Trista Goodman, another freshman, up next. Did not do the bars last week and hasn't done so since the Thunderbirds' last home meet here on February 3rd. But complete trust from Scotty Bauman and his coaching staff in the young freshman.
And that just goes to show the depth that the Flippin' Birds have on bars. Out of the gates as a freshman, she scored a 9.9 on bars at her very first meet as a Flippin' Bird. And it all depends on how you warm up in a meet, how you practice throughout the week. That depends on if you're going to be in lineup or not. And it looks like she had a good warm-up, good practice week this week to make lineups. Beautiful Pike Yeager out of a blind. Huge pack salto into a pirouette to handstand. Winding up, going into that blind full double tuck. Oh, looks like she had a little wobble on that landing. She did grab that stick. That double tuck was a little bit close to the bars. They sometimes can take a deduction for that, but other than that, that was a really clean routine by Trista.
Alyssa Voulage is up next, 9.85 last week on her vault season high.
Round out full on Pike off, 10-0 start value. Really beautiful vault, super clean, kept her legs together. Just a small hop on the landing and a great vault.
She is following a 9.725 from Sydney Coe and an even 9.7 for Emma Loyam. Caitlin Coe, meanwhile, for Southern Utah, gets a 9.8 even for her bars routine. And now competing for the first time this year, the senior from Stafford, Virginia, Nikki Thomas, did bars in all but three meets a year ago, has been a staple in the lineup on this event for Southern Utah, and getting back to the action here in Cedar City.
Nikki is another gymnast that you want to have in your bar lineups. This may be her first time competing this year, but she does have a ton of confidence and a ton of experience from her time competing last year on bars first up for every meet.
Looks like that 9.825 will pertain to Trista Goodman's score. And now Nikki Thomas set to follow it up.
Nikki's routine is very similar to Kate Coe. She does that same Maloney straight into a pack salto. Nikki is really good at nabbing those handstands right on top of the bar, which is just what the judges are looking for. Right into a double A dismount, huge dynamic dismount, just a little bit step backwards, but great first start for Nikki Thomas this season.
Great beginning to her 2023 campaign. Back over to the vault, Adriana Pop, the senior, the week five MRGC vault specialist of the week, is up next for the Broncos.
You'll see how dynamic this vault is, how quick she gets into the vault and the height she gets off of the vault. And you get that half turn, so she gets to see the landing, and she found it really well, opened her arms up, just a small hop, but a great, great vault, super clean. Broncos should be happy with that performance.
In front of her, Alyssa Boulage gets a 9.875, highest score in this rotation so far for Boise State. They started a little bit slow in the first rotation over on the bars, but finished very strong, and do have the same two gymnasts who anchored that first rotation for Tina Bird's team. Still waiting in the wings in Emily Lopez and Courtney Blackson.
That 9.875 was definitely deserved. A really beautiful vault for the Broncos.
Event number 2 of 4 tonight for Carly McClain. She is in the number 4 slot, and such an interesting strategy dynamic for Scotty Bowman as head coach. When you have someone as reliable and as competitive as Carly McClain, you can put her pretty much anywhere. You can have her be a strong athlete at the start. You can have her be an anchor, put her somewhere in the middle, and she really floats all around.
Mm-hmm. That's the great thing about Carly McClain, and that's what makes her a great athlete. She's super flexible. Wherever you put her, whatever lineup you put her in, she's going to do her job, whatever the situation.
Scotty can say that for a lot of his gymnasts this season. Wherever you put them in the lineup, they're going to build, which is exactly what you want to see in a lineup. You know, you put someone that is going to be a strong start and let the scores build as they continue on in the lineup. And it looks like the Thunderbirds are on their way there for this event. Situation I was mentioning earlier, where you never know how long you're going to have to wait before you compete, so you just got to be ready. But this is probably the thing we're talking about, so he's almost always ready.
Well, the scores continue to matriculate in. Boise State with back-to-back 985 plus scores on the vault. A 985 from Adriana Pop after the 9875 from Voulage before her. Southern Utah has gotten just 2 scores on the bar so far. 9.825 from Goodman, 9.8 from Kate Coe.
Carly McClain has proved herself to be a great bar worker over the years. Her release moves are huge. She has a big dynamic double A dismount, and she's always clean. Handstand into a clear hip. There's that huge ginger we were talking about. You can tell by the way she caught the bar, she was the perfect distance away to get that momentum into a beautiful kip cast to handstand, right connected into a bail. Here she goes after a beautiful handstand right on top of the bar into that huge double A dismount. Beautiful stuck dismount by Carly McClain. That should be a huge score for the Flippin' Birds.
That's one of the cleaner landings that we've seen so far tonight. And we go back over to the vault, and Emily Lopez, who shined once again, picking up where she left off from last week, a 9.95 with her bars routine earlier.
Beautiful, your tango full. She had a really straight body going into that landing, where she just had a little hop, but such a dynamic vault. And I saw her stick one in warm up, so I know it's in there, but still, just gorgeous, gorgeous ball. You'll see in this replay. Beautiful height, straight body. Knows where that landing is. Really great vault for Lopez.
And she has garnered MRGC Vault Specialist of the Week honors 4 times this year. Does not compete in the all-around, but we will see her most likely in 3 of the 4 events here tonight. Shai Murakami's up for the first time tonight, the graduate student who holds the school record on this event with a career best of 9.975 last year on February 11th against Utah State, so just about 10 days past a year to the day.
You can always count on Shailen Murakami to hit a great bar routine at the end of those lineups.
Carly McClain, they just announced to applause here in the AFEC. She's matched her season high with a 9.9 for their bars routine. So the score is continuing to build as Nikki Thomas in her first bars routine of the year, all the way here at the end of February, gets a 9.85 for Southern Utah, rewarding the faith that Scotty Bowman has had in her for the last couple of years once again.
Shailen Murakami has a huge dynamic routine. You see right there, eagle grip straight into a huge straddle Jaeger. She's so great at knowing exactly where those handstands are supposed to be, bouncing right on top of the bar, winding up for a full-in dismount, stuck landing. I really did not see much wrong with that routine.
We have our first 10 chance of the night from the Southern Utah student section. Back over to the vault in the number 6 slot, Courtney Blackson had a 9.9 last week and was the MRGC Vault Specialist of the Week.
A 1.5, again, difficult to difficult to keep your legs together during those huge vaults when you're twisting in the air, but she did it beautifully.
And now the final performer here in rotation number two, Ali Kotu, competing for the first time this season. Shai Murakami also has an even 9.9 for the Flippin' Birds. And now Kotu, the junior from Plano, Texas, has not competed in any event this year. And off she goes here at home for the first time this season.
You know, this being Ali Kotu's first bar routine, I'd say she should feel really, Looks like she just was a little bit too close to the bar, caught her off guard, wasn't able to quite get her hands over the bar. But she does have no pressure because of the five hit bar routines in front of her.
And every one of those scores at least 9.8 or above, with a pair at 9.9 and above.
Looks like she's recovered nicely with a great bail to handstand. Just gonna wind up for that dismount. Just a tad bit short of handstand right there. Huge double A dismount, just a little bit step backwards. That will be 5/10 off her score, but they will be able to drop that score with the five hit routines in front of her.
Well, both teams looking really strong here in rotation number two, a 49.275 on the bars for Southern Utah, identical to their score from last week, which matches their season high on that apparatus. So the Thunderbirds, who have not lost here at home since 2000. In Boise State's third consecutive win against BYU, Emily Lopez was the star with the fifth perfect 10 and the first on bars in Boise State history. And she is continuing to lead the way for the Broncos here on the road in Cedar City. We're welcoming back inside the Apex, Spencer McLaughlin, Megan and Maddie McBride alongside me. A 9.875 on the vault for Emily Lopez and a 9.95 on the uneven parallel bars. Megan, Emily Lopez is certainly in midseason form.
She is having a great night tonight, and you can just tell by the excellence of her gymnastics that those scores are so well deserved, and it's just another impressive feat to do on the road when the equipment might feel uncomfortable, you're not in your home crowd. It just goes to show what kind of athlete she is to be able to fit herself into any situation.
And Lopez leads the way on that second rotation. Southern Utah has headed into the lead here, but this is another look at that Lopez vault.
This is just pretty textbook Yurchenko full that you couldn't ask for any more out of anyone.
Southern Utah, meanwhile, a really strong second rotation, exactly what they were looking for, to retake the lead here, 98.35 to 98.275. The meet result still very much in question as we are halfway through, but the Thunderbirds got a lot of help in that second rotation there from Shai Murakami on the bars with her 9.9 after McLean's.
Definitely, and as Megan said before, put Shailen anywhere in your bar lineup and you can count on her to get those high 9.9 scores. It's just pretty much to be expected of her bars at this point, and you can tell just by her handstand, her landings, her amplitude, everything is just perfection, and she nails it every time.
So a pair of 9.9s for Southern Utah there. Boise State had a pair of 9.9s on that first rotation over on the vault, or on the bars rather. Those came from Lopez and Blackson with a 9.95 and a 9.925. That 9.95 from Emily Lopez, the highest score that we have seen so far tonight. Not her highest score of the year, of course, on the bars. But as you go into rotation number three in a meet as tightly contested as this between two teams, Megan, that know each other very, very well, what's the message from the coaches to their gymnasts?
Really, the one thing they're going to tell you is to focus on your gymnastics. There's so many things in this sport you can't control. You can't control the other team's gymnastics. You can't control the judges' scores. The only thing you really have control over is the gymnastics you put out on beam or floor or whatever event you're on. You know, just complete focus on yourself and on cheering for your team is really the only thing you can focus on, and that'll lead to success in the end.
Well, Boise State last year finished second at the MRGC Championships, which will be held here in Cedar City on March 18th, and we will bring that to you right here on ESPN Plus. What a blast that should be. Add Utah State and BYU into the mix, man. There will be a lot of highlights level gymnasts on the floor.
Oh, absolutely. This conference is a really competitive one, and it's exciting to have these conference matchups all throughout the season, knowing that the next time Boise and Southern Utah meet will be at conference championships, and seeing how close this meet is already at the halfway point just adds a level of excitement, not only for the gymnasts, but for everyone watching to anticipate the gymnastics that we'll be seeing in a few weeks with the two other conference teams here. It'll just be a really fun fight for all teams.
And this is the final dual meet of the year for both of these teams. Boise State, after this one, as you take a look at the MRGC conference standings, Southern Utah has been bested by just one team in all of their meets this year, and that was at the Best of Utah, taking second, their best ever finish there, with the Utes of Utah taking first, of course, one of the 5 to 10 best gymnastics programs in the country. But after today, Southern Utah will have a quad meet in Sacramento on March 3rd. 2 days later, they'll be at San Jose State before they come home for their final tri-meet before the MRGC Championships. Boise State, meanwhile, has a tri-meet and a quad meet before they take part in the conference championships. And it's, you know, a mess of scores to look at and such. But one thing you can see very distinctly there, Maddie, this is a Boise State team, number 32 in the country with their NQS score, sitting just under 195.7 right now. And they are starting to look better and better as they ramp up for the conference championships.
Yeah. You can look at the NQS scores and you can look at their scores throughout the season, but every meet is a new meet. It's unpredictable. They can best their score by a lot. They can have kind of a throwaway meet, so nothing is to be expected, nothing is guaranteed. So to see a team this late in the season to be improving at such a good speed is really, really awesome and something the Broncos should be very proud of going into this postseason.
So is Southern Utah just barely edging the Broncos of Boise State right now? Shai Murakami is up after a 9-9 on her bars routine, pops right back up and onto the balance beam in a rather unique way.
Not a mount you see quite often.
That is a crowd favorite here for sure.
Shailene, you go ahead.
Sorry about that. You know, we've been saying how, like, placement in lineups is something that the coaches and the gymnasts all think about, but it doesn't change, like, your place in the lineup doesn't change what level gymnastics you're at. Shailene Murakami has such high-level gymnastics you see here with her triple series. Oh, looks like she just missed her foot there. Hopefully getting back up on the beam to finish. And it goes to show, too, that you know, sometimes things happen, even with high-level gymnasts and fifth-year seniors like Shai. But that's why you have a solid beam lineup on the back end of you to follow up, to hit those routines. And that's what this team sport is all about.
So she'll have to be picked up by her teammates in the lineup behind her, Rachel Smith, Kaylee Coe, the middle sister of the trio of Coes that we will see tonight. Ellie Cacciola, Carly McLean, and Haley Vitaggio behind her. Pressure on all five of them to land their routines. And normally Murakami is someone you put at the start because it is such a rare occurrence to see her fall off the apparatus like that.
Yes, absolutely. And, you know, things like that happen. And, you know you've earned your spot in the lineup. So the people coming next after Shai's fall just have to trust their gymnastics. Focus on what they're doing in one skill at a time.
Our first floor routine of the night belongs to Alyssa Voulage, who had a career high with her floor routine at 9.85 last week.
Going into her first pass, round off 1.5 into a laid out front full. Tons of difficulty in that combo. It's always fun to see gymnasts having so much fun on floor because they do get to show off a lot of their personality on this event. When on the other events, there's really not much else you can do. And to see her teammates on the side of the floor doing that routine with her just shows how much support you have on the sidelines, especially at an away meet. Look looks like she's just gearing up for that last pass. A new rule in the NCAA is that if you have enough bonus in both of your passes and leap passes, you can have a two-pass routine, which is what she is doing, going into a double pike at the end. Huge dynamic pass, great chest up on the landing. Very clean routine for the Broncos to start off.
Zavulaj seeming to carry over the momentum from her career best outing last week against Utah, or against BYU rather, and Rachel Smith in a big spot right here, and a fifth year senior, a good person to do it after a fall.
Definitely. Rachel Smith is a confident, beating competitor, and always does it with a smile on her face.
To the floor exercise. Brantley Lucas, who stumbled a bit a week ago against the Cougars and had an 8.95, but the freshman garnering the full faith and confidence of head coach Tina Bird back out there here on the road.
That's the thing about gymnastics, is as much as we want to be perfect all the time, there's always going to be mistakes. But if you prove yourself throughout the week with practice and with warm-ups at the meet, and with previous performances in the past as well, you know, the coaches know what you're capable of performing and putting out on the floor. And, you know, to see what they do throughout the week and to have confidence in their warm-ups, you know, they're in a good spot.
And they're in a good spot here in their third rotation, a 9.825 from Boulage to start things off. Floor has not been the strongest event for Boise State this year. It's their lowest ranked event at 48th in the country.
Going into that first pass with a round off back handspring double pike. Looks like she just came out of that piked position a little too early, had to take that step forward. A few things you're going to want to look for on floor is those big dynamic passes with big amplitude, chest up on the landings and control on the landings, as well as those 180 degree split leaps in their leap passes. Second pass, round off 1.5, punch front layout. Super smooth. What you want to see on passes like that is for the second flip to get more amplitude than the first one. It looks like she executed that very nicely. And at this point in the floor routine, the one thing you're going to want to do is breathe. You've got one more pass. She'll be ending with a round off back handspring double tuck. Good controlled landing on that last pass. Altogether, clean routine.
So back over to the beam, where Southern Utah would love to have a strong score from Kaylee Coe, the one they call Young Money Coe. Caitlin goes by Cash Money Coe, which just begs the question, what is Sydney's nickname?
I guess we'll never know.
Have to do some digging.
What we've seen from Kaylee Coe in the past on this event has been really solid. So we'll see what she does tonight. And she does have a fall. Looks like she just opened her hips to the side as she was stepping backwards, which lends itself to falling. At this point, she just has to move along, keep hitting her skills.
She has not competed since She notched a 9.075 when she also had a fall at the Best of Utah. That was all the way back on January 13th. So Southern Utah here in the third rotation will be counting a fall in their score. And that opens the door for Boise State to move in front after they trailed entering this third rotation.
Haley Cohen's just had some little bobbles, but she's going into her dismount now. Gainer Pike.
Cachola, Carly McLean, and Healy Voltaggio waiting in the lineup for Scotty Bauman. Maloyam is up next on the floor. Last week was her second lowest floor exercise score of the year, so looking for a bit of a bounce back. A sophomore from Mountain Lakes, New Jersey.
To that first pass, round off whip double tuck. That whip adds a lot more difficulty to the skill, trying to find the right punch angle to go into that double tuck. You can see she has mats on the floor. Those are completely fine. You can have those on the floor with no deduction. Just saves your ankles a bit. For another pass. Round off back handspring, double pike. Just a little bit control on that landing. But again, huge difficulty in that first pass with the round off whip double tuck. And a great last pass, huge double pike, great routine.
Well, last time Ellie Cachola was on this specific balance beam, she guarded a 9.925 and set a career high. She has been exceptionally strong in her sophomore campaign here for the Flipping Birds.
The way Ellie Cachola approaches beam is just amazing. She's slow but controlled and also very in control of her gymnastics. You see she holds those landings, almost telling to herself, yep, I nailed that, moving on to the next. And it's really fun to watch. And like Rachel Smith does it with a smile on her face.
Looked like she did just a hair.
Okay, so probably small deduction there. And she will get that connection. That's one thing on beam you want to watch for. When gymnasts are connecting skills, if there's too long of a pause in between or a bobble, they will get a deduction.
For Cachola from her teammates. So we move back over to the floor, and Elena McGovern steps up, another sophomore for the Broncos. There aren't just a lot of underclassmen on this roster. A lot of them perform in big spots for Coach Bird, and it's an impressive thing to see.
Very impressive. You know, to have a young team like that can be difficult sometimes because you don't have that much experience from your young competitors, but that's why you want to put them in lineups early, because you want them to get that that feeling of being under pressure in a competition setting, so that when they compete later in their career, they will be confident. That first pass, we saw a front punch front Rudy into a layout step out. Looks like she was just a tad bit low on that layout step out, so that will be a deduction for amplitude. Another thing you want to look for on floor is the performance aspect. Judges are looking for that, and there can be a deduction if they see a lack of performance. So it's just best to go out there and have fun. It looks like she's doing just that.
Thank you.
the difficulty in that first pass, we should see her going into her final pass of her floor routine. Brown with back handspring, double tuck. Great chest up landing, and of course we love to see that control, and all together another great floor routine for the Broncos.
So now Southern Utah, more than ever tonight, needs a strong performance from Carly McLean as they'll be counting a fall here on the balance beam tonight. Ellie Cachola did deliver a 9.875 before.
And fall from Carly McLean on that first series. We'll have to count another fall, unfortunately. Sometimes on beam, it can be difficult to follow falls. What I mentioned before, beam can be a very mental event. And it can be in your head sometimes, but the key is just keep moving forward. Each routine is a new routine. Each skill is a new skill. Keep going forward.
And it just goes to show you how much can change in a week. Last week, up against Utah State, Southern Utah set a program record with a 49.45 on the balance beam. McLean had a 9.925 and took home medalist honors in that meet. A win for the Thunderbirds with a 197.125, and just a different story on the beam here tonight.
She's with a little bit step back on that dismount. You can tell she's not pleased with that routine, especially following a 9.925, but probably be back on her feet next week.
So both teams have had some good moments, but a little shaky here in this third rotation, at least compared to what we saw in the first couple when both were really, really sharp.
Right. And I think another thing to take into consideration is that these teams both competed this past Friday. So usually they have one full week to rest and recuperate and practice in between those meets. But in this case, they competed on Friday and then had just a few days to rest and recover before they compete tonight. And for Boise especially, they had to travel probably yesterday to come up to this meet here. And that does take time. It takes, you know, takes another practice day away. And so I think that's just another thing to consider, because these gymnasts, it's middle of the season, they're probably a little tired, and that's okay.
Here I was forgetting what day of the week it was.
It was like Friday.
As you said, yeah, because as she said, well, they competed last Friday. I was thinking, oh, well, they've had a normal week, haven't they? And then, yeah, good work, Spencer. That was really good.
Another thing to remember too is that these athletes aren't just athletes; they're student athletes. They do have lives and homework and everything beyond their athlete schedule. So they do have a lot going on in their lives, just outside of the gym as well.
This is Courtney Blackson on her floor routine.
Huge first pass, not one you see very often. Front handspring, front double full, punch front. That's what we call an E-pass. It's one of the more difficult passes that you see in the NCAA, and she executed it perfectly. Torjete split full, that meets the requirement for the leap pass. Because of the difficulty we saw in that first pass, she will most likely have a two-pass routine, but let's see if she surprises us. Round off 2.5. It's another difficult pass you don't see very often. Very difficult last pass to end on because of that blind landing, but great routine for the Broncos. They're having a really great floor rotation tonight.
Boise State has the advantage here in the third rotation, and Haley Voltaggio, who set a career high with a 9.925 last week, part of that record-setting performance by the Southern Utah beam team, would love to put up another score in that ballpark as they are going to count a 9-3 and a 9.25 from Kaylee Coe and Carly McLean. And Boise State has capitalized with strong floor routines on the other side.
Kaylee starts out with a difficult triple series here.
She stayed on the beam when she had that wobbly moment there. Southern Utah certainly didn't want to have a third fall that they'd have to count. So Sydney Leach, the freshman from Irvine, California, is up next on the floor to round things out and is beginning with a little M&M.
And Sydney can just go out and have fun tonight because the five gymnasts in front of her have hit routines. Another great double pike. Great leap pass from Sydney. It's always nice to see a freshman in that anchor spot, to see them perform so well under pressure, getting that experience that'll traject their career to their senior year. For that pass, we saw a front layout, punch front full. That second flip was a little bit lower than the first, so she will probably get an amplitude deduction there. This music is so fun.
I concur.
Got us bobbing our heads up here.
Winding up for the final pass of the Broncos floor lineup. Ground off back handspring, double tuck, stuck landing. No need to take that step backwards with a mic drop. We love to see it. Great floor rotation for the Broncos. They should be super happy with their performance.
Well, Boise State has gained ground and then some on Southern Utah. They will be taking a lead into the fourth rotation here in Cedar City. We'll let you know just how big it will be when we come back. Well, it's a bunch of 9-8 and above scores for Boise State as they make the rotation over to the fourth event of the night, that being the balance beam for the Broncos and the floor exercise for Southern Utah. Spencer McLaughlin with you alongside Megan and Maddie McBride. The good news for Southern Utah, Megan, they are 17th in the country on their floor routines this season, averaging over 49.2 per meet this year. The bad news is they're going to be trailing by over a full point here on a floor where they have not lost in over 2 years.
You know, it's always hard following a rotation where you have a fall, or in this case, more than one fall. But, you know, what Scott, I'm sure, is emphasizing is that we need to leave what happened on beam. We're moving over to floor where Southern Utah shines on this event. They are always above that 49.2, 49.3 mark on floor with amazing performances from all six of their athletes, and especially in front of a home crowd. You know, last rotation, I think they're going to really take the energy from the audience and the crowd here in the AFEC and use that to their advantage as they move on from that beam rotation they had.
Boise State, meanwhile, on the floor routine, it was their worst event last week in the win against BYU, notching a 48.925. They upped the ante to a 49.2, their second best score on that event this year, and it all started with Alyssa Vulaj starting things off with a really nice 9.825.
Yeah, that's a solid score to start out with. Generally, if you see 9.85s in all of those score slots, that's the average score you wanted to look at, and they've got a few 9.875s in there. And I mean, a 4/10 increase from last week to this week is a really good increase in score, so they should be very pleased with that. Definitely didn't look like it was one of their weaker events for the season, so they should definitely be proud of that rotation.
And the other thing, too, for the Broncos, you look at a 9.775 there from Brantley Lucas, a solid score when that's the one that you drop. That's when you know if you're Tina Bird that your team has put together a really, really solid event. And they got off to a strong start, had the lead after the first rotation. Southern Utah responded, went back in front after they went over to the bars. But now going into the fourth, it's Boise State with the momentum. What does Tina Bird tell her team in this spot going into the balance beam?
I think just to keep the momentum going. I mean, they've got something really good going tonight with their scores building and just consistent hitting routines. So I think especially moving to this last event where beam can make or break a meet, and just staying focused, staying calm, and trusting their gymnastics. I think that's the main message we're going to be seeing from Taylor tonight from the Broncos.
On the other side, for Scotty Bauman, it's a very different message, Megan, for his team as they go into that fourth rotation. I feel like the biggest thing he really has to do is loosen them up, because you saw some of that tension mount on the beam after that early fall from Shai Murakami.
Yeah, definitely nerves are higher after you follow a fall, especially in that first slot, because you know that pressure is on for every single gymnast following that fall. And it looks like the nerves got the best of a few gymnasts tonight, which is totally fair because it is 4 inches wide and they competed 5 days ago. But moving into floor, it's a new event. They have new energy. You know, I think the gymnasts just need to focus on the gymnastics that they'll be doing in the moment and just trust the training that they've done all of preseason and all of this season to get them through this next rotation.
The good news for Boise State and fourth-year head coach Tina Bird is that her team is number 18 in the country on the balance beam this year. It has been their strongest event all season long, and that could do nothing but boost your confidence as you go and try and close out a road dual meet in conference play.
Yes, and especially after following a strong floor rotation, which it sounds like they might not have had in previous meets, just to keep that high energy, but to control it in a way and funnel it into your beam routines where they really have shown this season, I think will be a really important thing for the Broncos to, you know, embrace going into this last event.
This meet tonight is the My Cause event. If you weren't with us earlier, the annual meet that Southern Utah does here at home, where each gymnast can support a cause that is important to her, and then there's a bigger cause that they're all following as well. And this year, it pertains to Boise State head coach Tina Bird, whose grandson Baker is battling congenital CMV, the most common infectious cause of birth defects in the United States, bringing attention and awareness to that issue and sending good thoughts and vibes Baker's way as he fights to get better. But Boise State here tonight has really, really competed well. And you know that that's been a part of the message as well. Everyone knows that that is what this meet is about, more than just the gymnastics that are taking place, but Boise State certainly responding.
Definitely. It just shows, you know, all these gymnasts coming together for their own causes, but also for one combined cause for Tina Bird's grandson, Baker. It just shows that, you know, this meet, this sport, these athletes, you know, their causes are bigger than this arena here tonight, and that they're all united in cause, which I think is really special and brings a cool energy to the meet tonight. You know, they're opposing each other, but really they're working together and standing together for united causes, which I think is a really cool thing.
Alyssa Vulaj is up first, and she is having an excellent night so far at that 9.825 on her floor routine to start things off in the last rotation.
She's approaching this beam routine the same way she did her floor, just attacking every moment. Super sharp in her landings, in her choreography, just shows a really strong confidence going into each of her skills. A gainer layout step out, a little wobble with that shoulder going to the side, but that is a very difficult skill, you know, getting all of that power off of one foot to get a full rotation and to land on a 4-inch beam. Very difficult. She looks very at home up on that beam. Great person to start a beam on. A front press. Again, just turning that shoulder a little bit, but kept both feet on the beam. It can be easy to just get in the stay on the beam mentality, but at this level, you want to achieve more than just staying on, and that looks like she's doing that tonight. Being very dynamic in her skills. Little step back, but a hit routine to start off the Broncos on their last event.
Ellie Cachola up first with her floor routine. Has already delivered a pair of scores in the 9-8s with her vault and beam earlier.
Ellie Cachola is a great person to start off a floor lineup. Not only is her tumbling huge and dynamic, but her performance is so fun to watch. And I think the energy she brings on the floor is going to help bolster the rest of the team as they continue on this rotation. Round effect handspring, double tuck. It looks like she didn't quite get the amplitude she was looking for. Chest was a little bit low on that landing. But what we've been emphasizing this whole night is you just got to keep moving forward and think of the next skill you're going to do. Looks like she's going into that front pass. Front full, front layout. You can see how much amplitude she had on both of those passes, which is just what the judges are looking for. Switch ring into a switch side towards a tay. See her teammates on the side doing the choreography with her, which is always so fun to see. She'll be ending this floor routine with a punch front Rudy into a split jump. It looks like her heel was just barely on the tape, but the judge did not raise her hand, so it was not out of bounds. Otherwise, great routine for Ellie Cachola.
So back over to the balance beam to Leah Little. And a 9.725 last week for Boise State, which is the score that her teammate Alyssa Voulage notched in front of her to begin things here in the final rotation for the Broncos.
Dancing between these skills. Very impressive just to keep moving along. Front side move, front aerial, connected to a beat jump. There are a certain amount of connections you have to have in a beam routine, including the leap, which she already accomplished. And all she's got left is her dismount. Landings, very dynamic gymnastics, should be a good score for the Broncos.
Haley Voltaggio, who has been really, really good on the floor this year for Southern Utah.
She's another great asset to the floor lineup for SUU. She adds fun personality to her floor, but also just has huge dynamic tumbling passes. Huge round effect handspring double pike. Front foot slid just a tiny bit. That'll be a small deduction, but great chest up on that landing. Now this pass is super unique. Usually you see these types of passes performed in the corner, but she does it on the side of the floor. Looks like she didn't quite get her feet under on that punch. She was supposed to do a front layout and instead did a tuck, but managed to stay on her feet. That will lower her start value significantly because of the bonus that she lost. that final pass. See, round off back handspring, double tuck. Great control on that landing. Just a little hiccup on that second pass, but other than that, great routine by Haley.
Ellie Cachola has a 9.75 to begin things on floor here for Southern Utah. And next up on the balance beam, the first and only performance of the night for Aaron El-Kabachi, senior from Murrieta, California, who had a season high 9.825 last week on her beam routine.
Bronco beam lineup. A few hit routines behind her. Layout, step out. Really solid landing. No question there. Jump to side aerial. Again, no question on that landing. Really great connection. Like her teammates that preceded her, just looks very calm and comfortable up there.
Last week, and she is one of the 50 best floor exercise workers in the country this year.
First pass for Carly will be a double pike. Huge double pike. So much control on that landing. You know, to follow a fall from any event, especially as an all-rounder, can be so tough, especially mentally, just to be able to let that go and move on to the next event. And for it to be floor for Carly, I think, is just a great way for her to move on from that, because this is where she really shines. Round off, 1.5 front layout. She just floats that second pass so easily. Great leap pass right there. Just one more pass for Carly McLean. She'll be ending with a round off back handspring double tuck. Great amplitude, great control. Overall, great dynamic passes from Carly McLean. She should be super happy with that.
So McLean calmly rebounds after the fall on the beam. Delivers what has the chance to be the highest Southern Utah score on the floor rotation here so far. Emily Lopez is up next on the balance beam. Two-time MRGC Beam Specialist of the Week this year.
She's really been having a solid night tonight. And finishing up on beam, goes into her series. The triple series of like handspring, step out, layout, step out, back handspring, step out. Definitely adds difficulty, and she executed it really, really well. Getting up on beam tonight and doing their job. No questions asked, looking very calm.
toss.
Routine there on the beam for Lopez. Carly McLean gets a 9.9 on the floor, and here is Emma Ingracia, who has not competed since Las Vegas, or excuse me, since January 9th in the home opener against New Hampshire.
She goes punch front into a double pike. Maybe just a little bit out of control on that landing, lift that front foot a little bit, but that front tuck into that pass will add bonus. So we should see a two-pass routine from Emma tonight. A triple leap pass as well will add some more bonus onto her start value. Got a little friends action going on.
Always a crowd favorite.
Last pass. Round off that handspring. Huge double tuck. You can see she landed with her chest straight up, which is exactly what the judges are looking for. Great routine for Emma. She should be super pleased with how she performed tonight.
Is up next on the balance beam. She herself has already competed tonight with a 9.7 on vault and a 9.85 on her floor routine.
Beam is a very unique event out of the four. You said she did floor and vault earlier, which are very high intensity, very high energy events. And beam, you have to take it a step back, calm down, a lot more breathing. And she's doing a great job, had a triple series. Back handspring step out, layout step out, layout step out. Just a little bobble on that toe turn.
For Southern Utah on the floor, a 9.9 on just her third floor routine of the year. That is a career best. Her previous mark was 9.725 that she set back on January 9th here at home against New Hampshire, and she blows by that score here tonight for the Flippin' Birds. And up now is Taylor Gold, a sophomore from Spanish Fork, Utah.
Another athlete that has worked her way into these lined ups and earned it. You can see with that first pass, huge dynamic double pike, great control on the landing, and also just another great performer. You can tell she's having a good time out there.
She's often been the anchor in the lineup for the floor routine for Scotty Bauman and his coaching staff.
A unique combo there. She went 1.5 front layout half into a huge split jump. Into that final pass. You see, round off back handspring, double tuck. Another huge pass from Taylor. Great chest up, great amplitude. Another great routine for the Flippin' Birds.
So Gull, who is in the fifth slot tonight instead of the sixth hole for Scotty Bauman, delivers a strong routine. Aubrey Schwartz still to compete on the floor. And the final Boise State performer of the evening is Adriana Popp.
Adriana is in a really good spot right here with solid routines from the first five teams before her. Just needs to go out, do her gymnastics. And the way she's looking right now, she's attacking everything that she's doing. And I'm excited to see what she does with this new routine. She did fall on that, but as you see, that was a very unique tumbling pass on the beam. Back handspring step out to a 2 foot back handspring, 2 foot layout. Huge amplitude on that. It is a very difficult pass to nail, but again, first five routines hit before her, so she's okay.
And those first five routines highlighted by a 9.9 from Emily Lopez, her second score of 9.9 and above here tonight. That puts Boise State in an excellent position.
Absolutely.
Going into the score tallying.
Finishes with a gainer layout full to end off the meet for Boise tonight.
And to end off the meet for everybody tonight, Aubrey Schwartz has had a 9.8 or higher in each of her last six floor routines. The junior and one-time MRGC Freshman of the Year. Up now for SUU.
Now, Aubrey usually doesn't anchor the floor spot, but again, this just attests to the gymnast's flexibility in being able to be put anywhere in a lineup and just rolling with it and performing how they always do. We see that huge front pass, front handspring, front double full. That is an E pass, so it's a ton of difficulty. Full leap combo, great control on that landing, hit that 180 split in that switch leap. Aubrey is a junior who has a ton of experience under her belt on this event. So even though this isn't her usual spot, she is another great athlete that you can put at the end of the lineup and you'll expect greatness. Front Rudy into a back layout step out. Great amplitude and control, not to mention a difficult pass to end a floor routine with. The Flippin' Birds should be really happy with her performance.
Now, Boise State in control at the moment. We'll tabulate all the final scores and bring them to you when we come back. Welcome back to Cedar City, the campus of Southern Utah University, where Southern Utah is poised at the moment to fall, barring some score changes for the first time since 2021. Boise State has been really, really strong tonight. We talked, Megan, before we came on the air and as the broadcast began, about how Boise State was off their best performance of the year last week in the win against BYU, putting up a 196.5, and they best that tonight with a 196.525, arguably even more impressive with it being on the road.
Yeah, especially to come to a home meet for 2 weeks in a row is tough on any athlete. Just not being in your home crowd, you know, in your home arena is a tough thing to do, but the Broncos took it in stride tonight and I think put out some really great gymnastics on all four events tonight.
Boise State came into this meet ranked 32nd in the country in terms of their NQS score. They finished 27th a year ago after making a regional appearance, and they're trying to get back to that level. And with the MRGC championships just a few weeks away, this is exactly the sort of momentum they want to be building towards on March 18th.
Definitely, and I mean, to know that they came away with their highest score of the season in this arena and to come back to that for MRGC conference championships has got to feel really good. They're already comfortable here in this space. They had a good performance here in this space, and that just brings a lot of extra confidence and excitement to come back.
Let's take it down now to the PA announcer to get the scores for the night and all the events and the final scores tabulated for each team.
On the ends of the parallel bars, in a tie for third place with 9.9 from SUU, Shyman Murakami and Connie McLean. In second place with a 9.925 from Boise State, Courtney Blackson. And with the high score on the evening with a 9.95 from Boise State, Emily Lopez. On the balance beam, in third place with a 9.825 from Boise State, Emma Loyim. In second place with a 9.875 from SUU, Ellie Cachola. And with a high score on the balance beam for the evening with a 9.9 from Boise State, Emily Lopez. On the floor exercise, with a tie for third place with 9.875 from Boise State, Courtney Blackson and Elena McGovern. And with a tie for the highest score for the evening with 9.9s from SUU, Emma Ingracia and Colleen McLean. Your high score for the all-around with a 38.75 from SUU, Carly McLean. And now for your team scores. Scoring a 195.525 in second place, Southern Utah. And scoring a 196.525, your winner, Boise State.
Well, the Broncos prevail here in Cedar City with their best score of the year. Southern Utah, their lowest team score of the year. And Megan, this is Southern Utah team that came in with so much confidence. Back-to-back scores on the road of over 197, which set a program record with a couple of 197.125s. Then they come back home, and this will be a test of the mental fortitude of this Thunderbirds team.
Of course, it's always tough to have a loss at home, especially after coming off of two really great road scores above the 197 mark, but it just goes to show you that things can happen. The gymnasts aren't perfect, and you know, it's getting to that point in season where you've had a few meets under your belt, you're probably getting a little tired, but that's no excuse to keep moving forward, putting your best gymnastics forward, and they will have quite a bit of time over the next like week and a half to recuperate and recover, and to keep practicing and to put this meet behind them, take away the good things, leave the bad things here, and to move forward onto the next meet.
There were certainly some good things for the Flippin' Birds. Emma Ingracia with a career best 9.9 on her floor routine, but it just goes to show you in sports and gymnastics, certainly no different. Every season is really two steps forward, one step back, and Maddie, that's kind of where it feels Southern Utah is at right now. They've climbed all the way to number 16 in the country with their NQS score. This will drop them back a little bit, but Southern Utah really did have some excellent individual performances tonight they want to build on, and Emma Ingracia on the floor was certainly one of those highlights.
Definitely, and I'm glad you said that because, you know, there were so many standout performances tonight from both teams, from Boise and Southern Utah, and it just goes to show that sometimes things happen, falls happen, there are fluke meets, fluke routines, and that, you know, there are still really good routines to fall back on and that they can expect for the next meet when they're back home and when they're on the road. So they're still really high caliber team. It's just sometimes meets like this happen and they just have to move forward and,
you know, take that confidence they've had all season and keep rolling with it and leave this one behind.
And full credit to Boise State. Tina Bird's team performed excellently tonight, particularly Emily Lopez. She was really, really good with a 9.875 or above in all three of her events. That is some high-level gymnastics.
She had a stellar night. You can tell that she just expects excellence out of herself every time, and it shows in her gymnastics, and I'm sure Tina Bird is just so pleased with her performance and is excited to see what kind of gymnastics she puts forward in the next few meets leading Boise after a great score tonight.
And the other encouraging thing, if you're the Broncos, this is where the conference championships, where Boise State finished second a year ago, will be held on March 18th. So now they're familiar with the travel schedule, the routine, every apparatus down there, having that feeling of comfort, Maddie. I don't think it's a small thing for Boise State as they try to continue to build confidence over their last few meets going into the league championships.
No, definitely not. And add to the fact that, you know, their scores have just been building and they have that confidence going for them going into these next few tri meets for them, ending up back here for conference championships. And I mean, again, both of these teams had really great performances tonight, so we should all expect very high-level gymnastics and a very exciting MRGC conference championships here in a few weeks.
And tonight, with how good Southern Utah has been at home, it's a testament to how strong the MRGC is. You can't have an off night and get away with it. BYU, Utah State, and Boise, in addition to Southern Utah, all such tremendously strong programs. Now, this is kind of the swan song for the MRGC, with BYU departing to head to the Big 12, which frankly just makes the MRGC championships that much more exciting. We certainly can't wait to cover that. We'll see if we can track down Scotty Pommen down there here in Cedar City. Back after this. Welcome back inside the AFAC. Boise State prevails in the dual meet with Southern Utah here in Cedar City. Joined now by SUU head gymnastics coach Scotty Pommen. And coach, everything was going according to plan after that first rotation. Your team trailed, came back in the second on the bars, but where did things go wrong for your beam team tonight?
Well, it was weird. That was very uncharacteristic of our beam team. They've been so solid all year long. But we tried to do some different things. We pulled Aubrey, and she warmed up great, but we were trying to give some of the girls a rest tonight, and she was one of the main ones we were trying to give a rest to. And put in Kaylee, and Kaylee's been great all year. She can hit that beam routine all day long. But Shylin warmed up pretty rough. But Shylin sometimes warms up bad, but always competes good. And tonight it just didn't translate into a good competition. So, you know, I probably should have made some adjustments in the warm-ups or after the warm-ups. But, you know, she's a fifth-year senior, and so is Carly. These guys don't fall on beam very often. And so, you know, this was just very uncharacteristic. We'll fix those problems up real quick, I promise. And I can't get mad at anybody. I'm the beam coach, so and so we've been mad at myself.
As you look at how your team had been performing the last couple of weeks, back-to-back 197.125s, road records for this program coming into this, then you take the step back here tonight with your lowest score of the season. What's the message to your team going forward?
Just, you know, it is what it is. We can't dwell on this. This is, you know, it was just not a good meet for us. And we had a hard time bringing the energy up down on the floor, I feel. And as a team, we've got to get better at that. But all we need to do is go out and hit our routines and do each skill one at a time. And we didn't do that tonight. And Boise State looked great. Kudos to them. But, yeah, we can definitely do much better. We left a lot of gymnastics out there tonight. And I don't see that really happening again.
Speaking of Boise State, the My Cause meet that you've turned into an annual tradition here in Cedar City was tonight. How special was it for you and your team to be honoring Baker Bird?
Oh, it was great. When we thought of this a couple of weeks ago, I called Tina and said, hey, we got a great cause with your grandson. And it meant a lot to her. But, you know, that's what this kind of a meet is for, to bring awareness to things like that. And Baker's going to have a fight his whole life. And anything we can do to help that family out is just, it's going to be great for them.
It wasn't all low lights for your team here tonight. You do take the loss, but individual standouts like Emma and Gracia on the floor. What did you see from her there?
I'm so proud of Emma. You know, but this is where Emma's been at for the last year. She was a little inconsistent at the beginning of the year, but we kept her in there. But then she rolled her ankle, and it was a pretty bad roll. But she's been ready to go back in that floor lineup for a little while now. And, you know, but who do you pull on? Our floor team's gone 49-5 or something like that, averaged almost 49-4 in the last three or four meets. So who do you pull out of there? And, you know, but it was good. It was good to give Rachel a rest tonight and let Emma go in, and because she scored a 9.875 in the exhibition at BYU. So that wasn't really all that shocking for any of us. She's an amazing floor worker.
Another thing that was not shocking was seeing Nikki Thomas return to the lineup.
Absolutely.
And nail it with a 9.85 with her bars routine.
I have been waiting all year long to put that kid back in bars. Again, our bar team has just been really ridiculously consistent. And, you know, who do you pull out of there? But this was a great meet to do it. We have... You know, we're really working on road scores right now, but, you know, it was important to have a good meet tonight. We just didn't. You know, and I'll tell you another thing. Aliko, too, the sixth bar worker that we had, she fell. That is a world-class bar worker. She just – that was not her meet tonight. And we want to get her back in there as soon as we can. And it was good to see Nikki go back in there. She's just a dynamic bar worker. Beautiful lines.
Well, Coach, as you go forward, what do you want to see your team take away from this meet to try to grow as you look at things like a quad meet in Sacramento, a tri meet back here with a couple of quality opponents, and then the MRGC championships?
I'll tell you what I do know about this team. This team is – something like this could be the best thing that happens for us. It honestly could. And this team is gritty. They're tough. They don't make excuses for anything. They you know, that was on them tonight. They struggled tonight, and they know it. But I also know this team will rebound, and they'll rebound and come back from this like it was nothing. So I'm not too concerned about it.
Well, Coach, it's good to hear, and we look forward to watching it going forward. As always, thanks for taking the time, and thank all of you for watching the My Cause meet here in Cedar City tonight. For our entire production crew and my outstanding color analysts, Megan and Maddie McBride, I'm Spencer McLaughlin saying so long. This has been a production of ESPN. All games and meets streaming live or archived in the ESPN app. Boise State bests Southern Utah with their highest score of the season, 196.525 to 195.525. We'll sign off for now. See you next time, whenever and wherever that may be. Hope you all have a wonderful rest of your night.